a retro episode looking at Kandy K. From the vault will be Woolway Entertainment TV content from back in the day, and it will be career retrospective of artists that have been interviewed and events that she's been doing over the last few years.
Wow, we worldwide out
here.
What's
up, world? How y'all doing? It's your boy Cole. I'm kicking it with the best, the beautiful Kandy Kisses. We are here in Miami shooting for Flo-rida, Pitbull, Lunch Money Lewis. Give you the green light. And we giving you the green light right now. Check it out. It's crazy. Check it out. Let's go. Bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase the band, show the money up, we chase the band, show the money up, bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase the band, show the money up, and I ain't doing no shit for the cut. Bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase the band, show the money up, we chase the band, show the money up.
What do you find is different now from being an artist that was, of course, signed to Flo-rida's label and now an independent artist?
I feel like it's harder when you're signed to somebody because of the outside pressures. Mm-hmm. Everybody's looking in and expecting a specific outcome. Mm-hmm. They're looking at you just expecting actions, right? So it's like things may look a certain way and really may not be that way. Or things may not look a certain way, it really are a different way.
Yeah.
You get what I mean?
Yeah, I totally understand.
You know what I mean? So there was a lot of pressure. I got a big buzz around it. Like, I was traveling the world performing, and I got the opportunity to perform in China, Alaska, New York, Vegas, Texas, you know, literally all across the world. And that's, like, something I'll forever be thankful for, you know, to Flo, having that opportunity to do that. And it obviously looks great on my resume. It looks great to the world, and it's a great experience for myself. But, I like being an independent artist. I have complete control over my music and what I put out. But it is definitely harder. It is definitely harder because you don't have that cosign there that may get you through some doors that may be harder for you alone to get through. Especially as a female, I got so much more credibility when I had a cosign. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But it was my decision to walk away and, you know, just go my separate way, that's all.
So how did you, for those who didn't know, how did you get involved with signing with Flo-rida?
He actually found me on Instagram.
Ooh.
Yeah, he found me on when I had 4,000 followers. I have 4,000 followers, and he saw me posting videos, freestyling in my car, cracking jokes with my brother, like, you know, calling him my chauffeur and shit like that. So he just seen videos like that and was like, you know, I want to see what you got. Can you send me some music? So I sent him some more music, and I sent him some shows I was doing. And he's like, you know, I want to fly you out and see what type of potential you got. And we was in the studio the first 3 days for like 72 hours straight, like no sleep.
God damn,
no
girl.
Sleep. So off that alone, off the amount of songs I recorded in a week and my hunger and how much, like, I wasn't focused on the clubs, I wasn't focused on sleeping, I wasn't focused on eating. Off that alone, he signed me off my potential, you know, back then, as well as my drive, my focus. So
that's good.
Ex bitch up on his line, but he ain't calling back. He said that she was just a thought, so he ain't thinking back. But he can't let it go, I see it though. Tell me what you frontin' for. I know this shit right here, nigga. This shit just be all for show. At least that's what it seems when you don't give a fuck. Them nights I threw the pussy at you, you was acting up. And when I tried to let you go, you was acting tough. So when I seen that you don't care, I said that's what's up. I had all kind of plans to spend, all kind of bands. You really just don't get it, I was your biggest fan. I was down to ride, showed you it was you and I. And though you seem the happiest, I know it's more than beats for ya. You know I had your back, nigga, better than a pull-up. If you said you missed me, yeah, you know that I would roll up. Anything you wanted, yeah, you know you had it shown up. You knew that I was riding like a motherfucking sticker. Whatever you want. Boy, you know I can't provide whatever you need. Oh, you know I was down to ride.
Bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew.
So, we also saw on Instagram stories that you deleted your snaps. May we ask why you deleted
which
your
ones? Because I always be deleting stuff.
Why do you delete stuff? Because, bro?
Okay, I'm very opinionated. Mm-hmm. And my words come off wrong sometimes. So people I already know how a lot of people take certain things I say. They take it out of context. So I'm like, oh my God, I don't need the argument, the online argument, you feel me? So I just like, you know what? Sometimes I'm up for like the debates, but sometimes people take things the wrong way and I'm like, okay, I get how someone can interpret that the wrong way, so let me just delete that. So if I delete it, it's not because I regret saying it, it's just because maybe I regret saying it a certain way or people may look at it as a certain way. Like for instance, I think like a week ago, I made a snap saying that I hate walking out the house with no makeup because every time I go out the house with no makeup, I see somebody that knows me from Instagram.
Yeah.
And it's like, damn, like, I really can't go nowhere without someone being like, oh, I know you from Instagram. And like, I mean that in a modest way. Like, it's not that serious. You know what I mean? Like, it's just Instagram.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Until my music is heard and people know the lyrics to my songs, I don't care about if you know me from Instagram. So it's just like, damn, I just want to walk out the house without someone being like, I know you from Instagram. You know what I mean? Do you get what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, I do. And then they act like they do know you personally. It's just like, girl, you're looking at them like, girl, it's just Instagram.
Like, let me just go get my shoes from Aldo where there's no makeup. Without
first off, do you even, my question is, do you double tap is a question. You know me from Instagram, but do you double tap?
Right, exactly. Because okay. I ain't seen you on my page before. That's what always happens.
So you are usually motivating your fans, giving them motivational speeches and things like that. Is this something that you enjoy doing whenever you speak to your fans? Is that something that you like?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I've been getting a lot of feedback about the inspirational snaps that I do every now and then. And I like to because I'm very opinionated, right? And I like to take anything that I've learned, and if I can help someone else out with their situation, or if I can help them out with something that I'm going through, and just telling them what I've learned without directly saying what I've been through, I feel like, why not? And I've been getting a lot of DMs about people like, thank you so much, you inspire me, thank you so much, I needed that right now. So you never know who you're inspiring, right?
That's good. You are also into fitness, girl. I see the body looking right, you got the old shoes on. Can you tell us, what's your daily routine? Like, what do you do in the morning? Do you work out? Is it more in the morning or do you do it during the day? How do you work out your fitness routine?
I usually work out first thing in the morning. So I usually get up around 9, in the gym by 10. And then I'll be in the gym for about 2-3 hours. And I do that about 5 to 6 days a week. Before it was 7 days a week. But the reason why I work out so much is because my hardest part is eating. The eating. Mm-hmm. The eating is the most important. So it's like I've seen so much definition when I flex, but the eating is what's going to stop me from getting defined, you know, real defined. So I try to work out like 5 times a week and mainly in the mornings. Sometimes I'll do it at night. Tonight's going to be at night because I was up early this morning handling some business, so.
Okay, so speaking of foods, what are some of your favorite foods, girl?
Girl. First off, candy.
Of course.
Candy, chocolate, that's first and foremost. But as for meals, shoot, I love my pizza. I'm addicted to pizza. I got a pizza like once a week.
Nice.
And Caribbean food. So I love curry chicken. I love jerk chicken. I love my rice and peas and pasta.
That is good. Jerk chicken, curry chicken. Take notes, guys. Take notes. She loves food.
And I can cook.
Ooh, see, look at that, heavy hitter right there. Not only is she beautiful, she could cook too. God damn. Now let's get into the music side, of course, because that's what everybody's been anticipating, like myself here. So last time when you spoke with Worldwide Entertainment TV and we interviewed you at T-Dot Fest behind stage, which was a major excellent performance of yours.
I go by the name of Kandy K. I'm here at Toronto Fest, the T-Dot Fest. It's a pleasure, man. Toronto's been so great. I just performed, killed it, did two of my songs called Sweet Love and Levels and a little freestyle to Wild Thoughts, Rihanna and DJ Khaled's song. Y'all can check out my music at YouTube or you can Google Kandy K Music. I got a new EP dropping real soon, so that's what I've been working on. So just hold tight. It's coming.
Damn, DJ Lo, he gonna turn on my Okay, you gotta keep it PG rated.
Alright.
Have you performed since, and how was it? Like, when? How was your latest performance?
The last performance I did, and I believe I was the only female artist on there as well. It was great. It was a different crowd. It was mainly men in the crowd, mainly men on stage, but it was a different crowd.
A different feel.
Yeah, totally different feel. More of that underground feel, but it was a success. It went really well, and I think the shows just keep getting better and better. That's how it's supposed to go.
I ain't seen no females out here performing. I could be wrong. So I felt like it was a sausage fest. I want to stir shit up a little bit. I'm going to start off with a little acapella, and then I'm going to drop a little record that's kind of hot right now. They say I'm too opinionated, shit, it's hard for me to fake it. Snakes showing love, man, it's hard for me to shake it. Should I strip or should I sell? Should I deal to pay a bill? Trick or go to hell? Only time will tell, and time's telling me that my tank been sitting on E. It's 5 a.m. and I'm writing the beats. My heart's beating double time just to make ends meet. I fucked up and let a nigga tell me how I can eat. I fucked up and let a nigga tell me how I can sleep. It's fucked up without a daddy to protect you from streets. Shit, I was working at the strip club, bitches giving dick rubs. I was storing drinks for nothing. Ballers for a pay stub. Karma came and hit me up. A nigga tried to take me out. Threw a molly in my drink. I was falling, tripping out. Years in the game and I never thought it happened now. All for a dream. I got stories for the world now. I go by the name of King.
Bad bitches in the crew. Bad bitches in the room. We chase a band. Bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase a band, show the money up, we chase a band, show the money up, bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room.
So I have a question. What's your routine when you're, you know, some people like chocolate when they're about to record, some people like to drink before they record. What is your routine before you hit the studio?
I'm the dullest person before I'm about to record, before I'm about to go on stage. Like, it's a total opposite. It's turned down time. Like, I just want my water, my gum, and I like to be by myself. If I have anybody in the studio, I want it to be like genuine friends. I don't like a bunch of people in the studio. I don't like to drink and smoke. I feel like it doesn't keep me focused. It keeps me sidetracked. You know what I mean? Like, I'm over here and over here versus being focused. And you know, I've had a lot of artists tell me, like, how do you not drink? How do you not smoke? Like, you got to turn up before you get in the studio. I'm like, it's not for me. If I go to the club, it's for me, because then I'm not focused. I'm just chilling, you know, in my zone or whatever. But for the studio, I need to be focused. It doesn't work for me like that. So I'm sober in the studio.
That's good. That's just like me. I can't do the drinking and smoking before I do all of that. That's way too much. Like, your head goes here, your mind's over there, your body's in one place, and you're just...
And you're picking up a bad habit. Why would you want to get into that?
I tell everybody to each his own, but everyone's different when they are in the studio. Some people got to have their weed and got to have their liquor for them to do what they do in the studio. And hey, if that's the way that you make great music, to each his own. But to me, and I guess to you as well, you gotta be sober.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
This week, WWETV Toronto covered the private listening party of Kandy K's Push Project.
Keep paying me the text.
bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase the band, show the money up, we chase the band, show the money up, bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase the band, show the money up, and I ain't doing no shit for the cut.
Like I try to do a diverse set of records so that I could understand what people like. Like if they like the Miami sound, that's what I'm gonna stick to, you know what I mean? If they like the New York straight raw sound, that's what I'm gonna stick to. That's why I did one of every record on the EP. So I think that like sums up everything I gotta say.
It takes a really strong person to be able to sit in a room like this, because I find that especially in Toronto, I mean I can't speak for LA and Miami, whatever, but I find that a lot of listening parties nowadays, people have lost the concept of what that is, and they put on these shows that they're just performing to the track, and like nobody can give their input, and everybody just leaves and they're like, oh, that was cool. But to be like in a really raw environment where people are able to give you this kind of constructive criticism or comments or compliments and all of that stuff, it takes a really strong person to be able to do that. And so like I give you credit for that.
Thank
because
you.
It's important for your growth kind of going forward. It was really easy for you to feel kind of defeated in the process so far, so like good on you, bro.
Thank you.
Damn, fuck, I'm so pissed. Bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase the band, show the money up, we chase the band, show the money up, bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase a band, show the money up.
So this one's called X Bitch. Oh, it's X Bitch. She look nothing like me. She a thot. She a hoe. I'm his fucking wifey. I'm nobody's wifey right now, but that's how the answer goes.
So where do you find the motivation and the inspiration to make the great music that you make?
Through experiences. I can't stand writing, making up stories, like, unless it's, I've been through it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't like I get all my inspiration through something I've been through.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of my R&B songs, or all my R&B songs, are about a dude I was talking to, about a dude I like, about a dude I'm in a relationship with. And even if I don't even know them that much, I use my imagination, you know what I mean? As long as I get inspiration from something, someone.
Mm-hmm.
And then for the rap, you know, if it's about some storytelling shit about some stuff I've been through, it's not hard because I've been through it.
Mm-hmm.
If it's some club shit, I write about things I've experienced. I write about my goals and aspirations, you know what I mean? Where mm-hmm. I know I'm headed, so.
That's good. Girl, you go, girl.
Thank you.
Do you get approached because you are beautiful? I'm sorry, I can't, you know.
Thank
a lot of females don't really go like this and let each other know how pretty or, you know, when they're doing big things.
Female empowerment.
Yeah, it's about being empowered. So have you ever been approached, for instance, doing other gigs such as acting or modeling, for instance?
Yes, I have. I actually started taking acting classes last fall.
Mm-hmm.
So I did like an acting boot camp, it really opened my eyes to look at acting in a completely different light.
Mm-hmm.
I also got my first gig. You ready for this? I played a lead role in Tory Lanez's movie, his short film coming out. So that should be dropping this year. And I played a lead girlfriend. So
yes, honey. And I know her. So
bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase the band, show the money up. We chase a band, show the money up.
So what has been some of the best and the worst advice you have got from people in the industry?
The best advice I've gotten was be humble and the grind don't stop. It does not stop. Like, you can't cheat the grind.
Mm-hmm.
So the grind is 24/7. You know what I mean? You can't say one day I want off and no. The grind is 24/7. I also had OT the Genasis.
Mm-hmm.
He told me, like, looked me in my face and told me, you know, don't focus on these dudes. They're just gonna get you sidetracked and they're gonna prevent you from achieving your goal. Make sure you focus on your goals and these boys will always be there.
Mm-hmm.
So as a man telling me that, you know what I mean? That, especially a dude in the industry, like, that meant a lot. And it was the way he worded it. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you're a beautiful girl and these guys are gonna try to mess up your plans. Mm-hmm. So just focus, get them done. I think the worst advice I got was nothing, because if it was that bad, I wouldn't have remembered it.
that's clearly right. Okay, so we've seen you doing some freestyles on your Instagram. So is it too much to ask as a female for you to spit a little something, or?
I'll tell you what, I'm going to spit something off my EP.
Okay, no worries, cool? Girl. I am more than happy.
Just
I am tuned
in. That's
what
I'm trying to promote right now.
No worries.
All right. I'm about to cuss, right?
Go ahead, girl.
They say I'm too opinionated, shit is hard for me to fake it. Snakes showing love, man, it's hard for me to shake it. Should I strip or should I sell? Should I deal to pay a bill? Should I trick or go to hell? Only time will tell, the time's telling me that my tank is sitting on E. It's 5 a.m. and I'm writing the beats. My heart's beating double time just to make ends meet. I fucked up and let a nigga tell me how I could eat. I fucked up and let a nigga tell me how I could sleep. It's fucked up without a daddy to protect you from streets. I'm gonna stop there.
Oh, girl.
Because the rest gets a little, graphic.
Oh, girl. God. Oh, my God.
You're going to have to wait for the rest for the EP. But
girl, that was so dope. And as a female, like what we were talking about off camera, it's kind of like what I was telling you. Like, us, it's harder for us in this industry for us to come up. Because, A, a lot of females don't really give props to other females and say, hey, yo, she's dope.
Right.
You understand what I mean? And it's a lot of us that are not seen or not heard. And then there's females like you who are out here who's pushing for us to, you understand what I mean? There always needs to be somebody who needs to be in the forefront. And I feel by you being in the forefront is paving a way for females like myself and other females, like my homegirl Roots and things like that, for us to come up. So what kind of advice can you give girls like us who's trying to come up in this industry?
It ain't easy. But at the end of the day, if you can't cheat the grind, like I said, like, that's one of the top pieces of advice I got. You cannot cheat the grind and the grind don't stop. You got to eat, breathe, sleep it. Like, there's been so many nights I haven't slept because I'm literally up writing or I'm up just thinking about how I can better my goals and make my dreams happen. Especially for women that, how do I word this? See, this is why I would delete a snap, right? Especially for women that are trying to take the sexier route, like in regards to the boobs, the, you know, the ass out and stuff like that, it's going to be even harder for them because men are sexualizing them. Mm-hmm. And all I can say to those women is, or all women, is do not sell yourself short.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you do, that's one thing I've learned and been and taught, you know, in this industry, is I've had almost every male tell me, like, do not sell yourself short. The moment you give it up in the industry is the moment word's going to spread so fast. And it's like, you're going to let a dude ruin your reputation? You know, is that how you want to have your come up?
Yeah.
And that's not how I want my come up. So if I could give any advice, I would just say, just keep your dignity, your morals intact, and just grind. Like, grind and take every opportunity you can by the balls. You know what I mean? Don't just walk into a room, like, step in that bitch and make your presence known.
I always do, girl. I step. Don't you see my Tim's, girl? I step in that. But yeah.
Don't capture my ugly.
Shout out to WWETV. Make sure you subscribe to the interviews, all of that good shit. Make sure you show love because they show love to the culture.
Kandy K, as she speaks at T.Dot Fest music panel about meeting Snoop Dogg, her hustle, and travels worldwide.
You're the queen. That's when you the medals. You're the queen of the North. This is Game of Thrones for real. That's right.
You know, once upon a time,
I was Denzel in my day. And you was right there too. And it was only in a dream, but you gotta visualize it.
And who was I?
Huh?
Who was I?
Shit, you was the queen. We was truly the Game of Thorns. So how you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
Thank you for taking your time off your busy schedule.
Thank you for having me.
And I know you got a lot of things coming up for the fall and for the spring. You just got back in town, right?
Yes.
Where were you?
Atlanta.
Ooh-wee, hot Atlanta. Okay, you see my boy down there, CBJ?
No.
But that's like my little son.
Oh,
I raised him in this game.
Okay, gotta say what's up next time.
There you go. So let's tell everybody about you, for those of you who don't know you, where you came from and what you've done and what you're doing now.
So I go by the name of Kandy K. I've been in the game for about 10 years now. I've been taking it seriously for about 7 years. I started off when I was 12. I was really interested in poetry in school. I aced it. It was my favorite subject, like English. I was doing really well. By 14, I started having a lot of male friends that were in the rap game, trying to become rappers, putting out mixtapes. I just started to have an interest in the rap aspect. I already knew a little bit about songwriting in regards to R&B and stuff, but I really wanted to take an interest in rap. So I asked some of my male friends to try to teach me how to rap. It started off with the ABC rhymes. It turned into being more lyrical. By 15 or 16, I had my first mixtape. I did it on my own. I engineered everything, found whatever beats I could online, and saved up money from the graffiti artwork I would do on clothes, and bought my own studio in my room. Put it in my room, set it up, was giving out mixtapes for free. My second mixtape I put out when I was about 17, I started selling them for $5. So I had about 4 mixtapes, and I just hustled whatever way I could. I wanna say it was the third mixtape I did. I came across someone, and it was just random guy. I like to write, I like to record, and it was just a passion that I had. So I went out there with my mother. We recorded a little bit. I got really, really, really sick. While I was out there, I was, you know, throwing up. It was really bad. And I told Jeff one day, I said, I don't think I'm gonna be able to make it to the studio. I'm really sick. And he basically, like, long story short, he gave me the speech like, hold up, I flew you out here and you're not about to come to the studio? Do you know how many people would die to be in your position right now? Like, I'm the one that made Alicia Keys. So I'm like, no, it's not that. I'm just letting you know, like, I might throw up in the studio. And he's like, I don't care. Like, you got work to do. So I didn't know the grind that really came behind the music. I just knew the grind that was in my head, which was selling mixtapes wherever I could, which was literally getting outside of my car on the highway with jam-packed traffic for Caravana, and literally getting out my car on the highway and throwing mixtapes in people's cars, or showing up to whatever clubs I could when I knew artists were in town and doing whatever I had to do to get them my music. That's the hustle I knew. I didn't know the studio hustle. So I showed up to the studio and, you know, we got the records done. Thank God I was not sick. But he flew me back, and I knew it. I'm like, I wasn't ready. You know, I'm like, I still have a lot to learn, and I knew that. So moving forward, that was when I was about 19 now. And whenever there was, like I said, celebrities in town, I would just try my best to just show up. Like, a story real quick, there was Snoop Dogg came to town, and I found out last minute. And I was like, damn, I gotta go to the Snoop Dogg party. I met him a few days prior at this video shoot. He was like, I'm having a party in a couple days, come through, and I forgot. So I'm like, damn, I gotta go. So I rushed to Best Buy, pick up an MP3 player, put like 3 songs on it, my best songs, pick up my homegirl, we on our way, car breaks down. I'm like, oh my God, how am I gonna get to this? Like, we all dolled up, I got my music ready, I gotta go. I make a call to one of my friends, I'm like, hey, I really need a ride right now. He's like, all right, I got you. How are you getting home? I don't know, but let's just go. And I live like an hour from downtown. So we go, I get there, club's at full capacity. I'm like, what are the odds? Like, I just can't win tonight. So I'm like, nah, like, you don't understand. I really just gotta go in there to give Snoop my music. That's all this is about. I don't even wanna party, like, you can come in with me. And he's like, you don't understand. The club's at full capacity, like, it's a fire hazard. I'm literally outside stressing. Like, how am I don't even know how I'm getting home. Like, I just need to get Snoop my music. Long story short, I see one of a guy I knew, and he walks by, he's like, what are you doing outside? I'm like, I can't get in, like, I just came here to give Snoop my music. He's like, what you mean? Like, I know the owner, let me talk to the owner. The owner's not budging. He's like, it's full capacity, bro. He's like, listen, I believe in what she's got going on, 200, just let her in, lets me in. By the grace of God, right?
Money's king.
So I get in, and I'm like, where's Snoop? Find Snoop. All security blocked off, obviously, so I was about to go in one of the top booths, because there's a downstairs and upstairs,
and I see some friends I know. So I'm like, hey, I just need to get in there real quick. They're like, no problem. So I'm reaching down over the balcony trying to tap Snoop's head, and he's surrounded by a bunch of girls. Security's like, oh, whoa, 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 miss. No. This isn't about to happen. I'm like, you don't understand. I met Snoop the other. He's like, I don't care. Snoop looks up. He's like, oh, what's up, Kandy? I'm like, man, I just brought you my music. He's like, all right, cool. Long story short, a week later, he gets back to me. You know, I love the music, keep going. And he just gave me a push, like, you got it, so just keep going. You know what I mean? And that was enough for me. At the end of the day, that's another person that knows my name, has seen my hustle. That's all that matters. Now, fast track. I'm about 19, 20 now. I'm in school. You know, my mom wasn't really supportive of the whole music thing growing up. My parents weren't together. I didn't really talk to my dad. And I was really just focusing on getting this degree for my mother, because she did that. That was what would make her happy. I knew at the end of the day, I've always wanted to be an artist. It's just something I've always felt. I literally went through a list of hundreds of jobs. There's nothing that I want to do other than the music. So I get my degree, don't even want to go to graduation. I said, here's the papers, mom, like I'm done. We made an agreement, I could do whatever I want. You would support me moving forward. So she said, okay. I want to say I was 23. I had just graduated, I couldn't find a job. It was the first time ever I couldn't find a job anywhere. Grocery stores wouldn't hire me, Foot Locker wouldn't hire me, nowhere would hire me. I went to do social work, that's what I got a degree in, was social work. Nowhere would hire me. Daycares wouldn't hire me, nothing. Every time I thought I got the job, they would not hire me. It was like I was overqualified. It didn't make sense to me. All of a sudden, I get my degree and now no one's hiring me. Like, man, this is music, I just gotta go hard. Randomly, I get a job in IT. A friend hooked it up. Know nothing about computers. I'm in there and I'm just like, man, like I can't be in a cubicle for the rest of my life. This cannot be my life. It's not for me. I'm not knocking it, but it's not for me. And randomly again, I think it was an email from someone on Twitter, and he's like, I really believe in what you got going on. How can I help? How can I contribute? I said, I just need shows. And next thing I know, we start doing a couple shows. Before I knew it, people start hitting me up on Instagram. Flo-rida finds me on Instagram. He finds me on Instagram, says, where can I hear more music? I send him a couple songs, I send him links, and he goes, I'm really interested, I wanna fly you out. I wanna see what you can do in the studio. Fly out to Miami with my mother, and we were in the studio the first 3 days for 72 hours straight. No shower, no nothing.
Wow, it's just that. It's amazing to hear your story. And were you teachable? Because a lot of artists are not teachable and they don't know it. They don't even need a manager. They don't want a manager, they want an investor. They say they want a manager, but they want an investor for real, because they can't be told nothing. So did you have that mentality when you went out, or had to back it up, or were you always teachable?
I've always tried to be a student to everything, but especially as a female, you have to hold your ground without trying to be a know-it-all at the same time. So a lot of things, it kind of conflicts sometimes, because you try to like stand your ground with certain things. Like it could be something as simple as what you wear or your style or the things you say in your music. And you may want to stand your ground because that's who you are, but you have to know, all right, I can tweak this because this person may know better than I will. You know what I mean? So I'm very open-minded when it comes to what I talk about in my music, just because I'm okay with whatever it is I want to talk about. I'm okay with whatever it is, you know, someone else, my management may want me to talk about, because I know well enough now that, you know, my management or the next person may know better than me. But at the end of the day, like I can't remember who it was, someone said that they, you know, their goal is to inspire people through the words of their music. You know, I'm a little different in that sense. I more so want to tell my story. I want to be able to get on a platform where I'm able to tell my story, you know, through my platform and inspire a lot of women. That's my goal.
That's cool. You like it. Wow. you kind of deep. I didn't expect that. As an interviewing you, you know, I've heard a lot about you and heard the things that you've done. But to hear your grind and to know that, I know that your grind is real, you know. But, I mean, does anybody have any questions?
Contact.
My email is Kandy, K-A-N-D-Y, the letter K, music@gmail.com.
Okay, I have one. So when you started dealing in Atlanta and abroad and all these places, first of all, obviously your music changed after you came off the road because you've seen a lot of things, right? What do you, I mean, Toronto, and I'm from the States, Toronto talent is just crazy. I mean, from dancing to videographers to producers from their stories. And what do you think is the hardest hump for them to get over? I mean, because it's like every city gets their sound. Right now it's Toronto, and you know, in the next 2 years it may be somewhere else. But
with accents, you'll learn a lot with style. You'll just learn a lot by traveling. And in my personal opinion, I feel like America has always been the root, and they've always had a foundation for style, slang, the newest lingo. They have the newest everything. And I feel like Canada gets everything later. That's my personal opinion. So with that being said, I feel like it's important to travel so we can pick up on a couple words or pick up on the newest stuff, the newest looks. I'm not saying anything's wrong with Toronto by any means, but I am saying I think it's important for artists to pick up on different things everywhere. I have people tell me now, like, I've gotten this American accent, or, you know, I look more American now. And it's like, I've spent four or five years in New York and Jersey, you know what I mean? Like, living there. So maybe unconsciously, it's rubbed off, you know? Or I've spent another 2 years in Miami. So that stuff's gonna rub off on you, your style, your words, your lingo. And I've noticed it. Like, sometimes I say things that some people out here don't say, or vice versa.
You know what? And that brings me to a point. Back to Toronto, I'm sorry, I'm a fan. Maybe y'all don't see it, but I see it from outside.
Absolutely.
And that's why I'm here. And I'm here because I don't like none of the executives here. I want to be the Clive Davis here. I think they're full of shit. Because anytime America got one slang that's going on right now, does anybody know what America say? Females called dudes up and said, let's drive and drink. Have y'all heard that?
What?
They driving and drinking. Not drinking, drinking. To Drake's music. That's the slang now. We driving and drinking. So if y'all don't understand y'all got that shit, I don't know what the hell to tell y'all. Cause they tell a female, let's drive and drink, cause they say driving and drinking is Drake's got that music that female wants to hear. So it's not driving and drinking, it's driving and drinking. I said, oh shit. I got one, see, I'm old and I got one up on y'all. Denise, let's drive and drink. So, you see what I'm saying? So, you know, I've been trying to tell you, y'all got that stuff, man.
My experience, artists in Toronto support each other the least. And I feel like if we really supported each other, males supporting females, and females supporting males, it could really do damage. Because everybody's looking in Canada right now for artists.
What? And you know what? I think that's good, but we got them, you know, when Meek Mills wanted to sign Robin Banks, right? But that's not his name? That was showing them press everybody's coming, so I think we can get on this bandwagon and support each other, but we got to take knowledge. The OG, you got to teach these kids. Because the kids, the younger artists' bigger problems is that the old artists didn't reach back for us. That's every young artist, when you talk to them and say, hey, what about so-and-so and so-and-so? They say, man, they don't look for us. So they like growing up on their own in this industry. And y'all dudes know, and y'all responsible. And all these people that say you do social media, you do that, don't take these kids' money, man, and don't do nothing.
Bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase a band, show the money up, we chase a band, show the money up, bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase a band, show the money up, we chase a band, show the money up, bad bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase a band, show the money up, and I ain't doing no shit for the cut. Bitches in the room, bad bitches in the crew, bad bitches in the room. We chase a band, show the money up, we chase a band, show the money up, bad.